Hello, everyone. This is Kevin Lynch speaking to you today on behalf of the Barbershop Harmony Society. I have the great privilege and honor of being the Chief Strategy Officer here at the Barbershop Harmony Society. And this video today is a presentation of the full results of our 2016 member satisfaction survey that was fielded in the spring of this year, 2016, and presented to our board of directors and some other parties at the annual board meeting on July 4th, 2016 in Nashville, Tennessee. I will be speaking during the entire presentation, but most of the presentation that you see today will be on a series of PowerPoint slides. I'm going to take this moment now and jump to the, I'm going to share my screen so that you can see those slides, if you'll just give me a moment. And I believe at this point that you should be looking at my full screen. I'm going to start speaking and speaking for a long time, so I hope that you can see it, because I'm not going to be able to stop and find out whether I did it right until I'm done. So fingers are crossed. By way of introduction, this survey is part of a long-term strategic planning process that the Society embarked upon at the very end of 2015 and will culminate in the completion of a new long-term zero-based strategic plan in May of 2017. So it's an 18-month process, and the first several months of this process is what we're calling the gathering stage, where we're gathering opinions and understanding from a wide variety of stakeholders, none more important than our members themselves. This survey focused specifically on the current state of the Barbershop Harmony Society at the time that the survey was taken. So it focused primarily on how our members are feeling in many, many different ways about the current state of the Barbershop Harmony Society. It is not a survey that looks at the future, although that survey is about to come out, but it took a current state picture of how our members are feeling about the society. Now, the way the presentation will work today is that I'm going to start out by going through some high-level concepts, and I'm going to present 12 key takeaways from this research. If you only stay around long enough to watch those 12 key takeaways, you'll get the essence of what we found in this survey. You won't get the data to back up those assertions, but you will get the key ideas that we found in this survey. Following that, we'll take a quick breather just in time for me to clear my throat and go on. And then I will go into detail on the data that supports those assertions. And that'll be through a series of slides that are pretty detailed in terms of how they look at the responses that we got from our members. So with that in mind, I'm going to start by talking about the purpose of the survey itself. You've seen a lot, we hope, about our strategic planning process and about the gathering work that we're doing in that process. This is one key step in that process. And what we're trying to do with this particular survey is look at what are the indicators of member satisfaction? What are the things that would make somebody happy or unhappy with being part of the Barbershop Harmony Society? How do the members feel about how the chapter that they belong to, the district, and the society as a whole is performing? And then what do we know about the profile of those members in terms of their demographics and how they tend to use Barbershop? We got enough replies to this survey that we're able to dig down into the sum of the data and look at it not just at a collective level, but at how specific groups or subgroups or segments of our population look at satisfaction and performance for the Barbershop Harmony Society. This data will also be used in the future as a baseline for future measurement of progress on key indicators. So it is our intent that starting in December of 2016, we will do this survey with each group of members that are nearing their expiration date, excuse me, and measure any changes in their satisfaction and in their perceived performance of the Barbershop Harmony Society, so that we can continue to monitor how we're doing and how we can serve them better. As I stated before, one of the purposes is not to address the future directions of the society. That is not within the scope of this survey. It is a separate study, and it is actually going to be fielded beginning August 8th, 2016 through Labor Day of 2016. So if you're viewing this video during that time window, we would strongly encourage you to take that survey that focuses on future concepts. The method for this survey was through an online Survey Monkey instrument. Most of the questions, not all of them, used a format that's called a Likert scale. This is a pretty tested and reliable research method where a statement is made and then the respondent is asked to state on a scale of 1 to 5 their agreement or disagreement with that statement, with 1 indicating that they strongly disagree with the statement and 5 indicating that they strongly agree with it, and then gradations of that on 2, 3, and 4. Each question also is accompanied by an option of an NA, meaning simply that the respondent feels that he or he does not have sufficient information to even answer the question. There are a few questions in the survey where we used a ranking protocol rather than a rating protocol, and I'll explain those when we get to them. It's designed for cross-tabulation, again, by collecting demographics of the respondents. We're able to take some questions and drill down into what specific segments had to say about that. Some questions had question logic applied, meaning if they answered a certain question a certain way, it would skip them to a different question. And then finally, there was a series of open-ended comments at the end that are not being reviewed in today's presentation, but where we received extensive written comments from members. The survey was open from May 16th through June 20th of this year. It was promoted through an email to our members at the beginning, and then several announcements on our live wire and a snail mail to 1,400 of our members for whom we didn't have an email address. We're happy to report that we had nearly 3,000 replies to this, 2,894 to be exact. 2,663 were by email, 231 were by the snail mail replies, and then our trusty intern, James Isley, input all of those 231 replies into our Survey Monkey instrument so that we could look at the data side by side. This is a good response rate. It certainly gives us confidence in the reliability of the results. Statistically speaking, this level of response, 294 replies versus a membership of approximately 22,000, means that we can be 95% confident that any given answer or any given data that we're looking at is within a 1.7% margin of error. That's when looking at the group as a whole. When we're looking at smaller subgroups, the margin of error becomes a little bit higher because of a smaller sample size. Now, with all that said, my belief typically on a piece of research like this is that it tends to favor the more optimistic members of any group. It was not an inconsequential piece of research for somebody to complete, and therefore the people that complete a piece of research like this tend to care enough about the organization that they would take the time of day to do this. In terms of what we studied in this survey, we first of all collected the respondents' profile and their demographics. We asked them for some information that would identify the kind of chapter that they come from, and in many cases, the chapter itself. We asked them, where do they get their personal satisfaction? Where do they get their jollies from Barbershop? And what's the level of that personal satisfaction? We talked to them about the most important aspects of their Barbershop experience. We gave them a list of member benefits and asked them to rate the relative value of those memberships. And then we asked how we're doing as a chapter, as a chapter, as a district, their district, and then as the Barbershop Harmony Society as a whole. And finally, we asked them about their philanthropic intentions, given how important the support of our donors is through the Harmony Foundation. Now, I mentioned at the beginning that I would go through some high-level conclusions, and I'm about to start these now. So there are, I would say, 12 key conclusions from this data that if you take away nothing else from the presentation today, should give you the essence of what we found. The first key conclusion is called demographic isolation. At least that's the phrase I'm putting on that. And what this means, and it's probably no surprise to anybody viewing this, is that the Barbershop Harmony Society today, at least as represented by these nearly 3,000 respondents, is primarily a white male organization. We all know that it's primarily a male organization in terms of our membership. This survey indicated that 95% of the respondents are Caucasian. So as an organization looking to the future, the issue of demographic isolation and whether we really represent the world in which we live and the world in which we would like to serve is something that we need to be very, very cognizant of and have that guide many of our intentions going forward. Second key conclusion had to do with the role of quartetting. Interesting phenomena occurs in this research. Virtually everybody who responds to the survey is interested in and has participated in quartetting. But there are a few chapters that are focused around quartetting. And the chorus, in most cases, is indicated as the more important point of affinity than a quartet. So this would lead you to ask this question, which comes first, the chicken or the egg, the quartet or the chorus, the chorus or the quartet? Now, the survey doesn't really answer that question as to which comes first, but it tells us, perhaps at a level that we weren't really front of mind aware of before, that we need to pay attention both to quartetting and to chorus singing as points of engagement in the society. The next conclusion is about grassroots engagement. You know, there's a lot of different ways to engage with the Barbershop Harmony Society. You can certainly engage with your chapter. You can engage at the district level in a leadership role. You can engage on any number of committees. You can even become a member of the National Board of Director or serve on a national committee. You can serve in online communities. You can serve in sub-communities, whether those are communities of woodshedders, or bulletin editors or anything else. But of all the different ways that members of the society have to engage with barbershopping, they choose more than any other way to do that at the grassroots of their chapter. We asked people in this survey about their use of our main events, those being the International Convention, the Midwinter Convention, the Harmony University, and then the district and divisional conventions that are available to them as a member, and made an interesting observation about the balance of those events. By far, the most heavily used events by our members are their district and their division contests and conventions. The data will show extremely high use of those compared to the other events. And yet these are ones that, as we plot the future of the organization from a leadership standpoint, the society as a whole doesn't have a lot of ability to influence from a branding, messaging, partnership, and outreach standpoint. So we put a great deal of emphasis and effort into our national events, the International Convention, the Midwinter Convention, and the Harmony University. And yet perhaps the greatest opportunity to influence our members and to influence public perception of barbershop is at our regional district level events. This next conclusion is something that probably every barbershopper has felt and which keeps probably every barbershopper continuing to be a barbershopper. And it's called the mysterious alchemy of singing together. Revealed time and again in this research is this idea that there's sort of four things that when you blend them together create a mountaintop experience that causes a man to want to continue in this hobby. When you take the ability to ring chords, together with other men really, really well for the benefit of others, some magic happens. Some true magic. It might be represented theoretically by the overtone, but I think it's more than that. It's truly a greater thing that comes out of that cauldron than went into it. Ringing chords together really well for the benefit of others is sort of the secret sauce that keeps people coming back for more. Speaking of secret sauce, let's talk about the youth who responded to this survey and their enthusiasm. On just about every indicator of success and every indicator of satisfaction, every indicator of engagement, across the board, youth tended to be much more enthusiastic, relatively speaking, than the rest of our members. Youth enthusiasm for the Barbershop Harmony is fantastic. And I made the little comment here, if we could bottle it, we'd make a fortune. By the way, I'd like to apologize. I'm actually recording this from my home office today on Wednesday, August 2nd. And on every Wednesday at this time, they do a test of the tornado sirens. And so that siren that you hear in the background is the tornado siren. I'm keeping my fingers crossed that it actually is the tornado siren and not the tornado itself. It'll go away in a moment, but the way I need to record this is to start at the beginning and not stop. So I'm going to keep going. Thanks for your patience with that. It seems to be dying down now. Well, along with the overall enthusiasm of the youth, which many of us see when we see young men singing at our conventions and our events, is an equal phenomenon which has to do with the personal development of young men. And I found this very fascinating when reviewing the data. Young men like all the things that you'd expect them to like about singing and about barbershopping, the same things that most members of the society enjoy. But it was interesting to note that young men also had a keen understanding of the impact on their own personal development as men, or as good men, or as emerging good men, that comes from barbershop singing. So we talk about how barbershop singing changes lives and improves lives, but the young men who responded to this survey actually were able to score that rather highly in terms of the role of barbershopping on their own personal development. That was an interesting and I think a very exciting finding to the research. The next conclusion is what I'm calling the risk of moderate satisfaction. And this is a very important one for us to take real strong note of and to look at it, I think, as a risk to our future. And at its essence, what this idea is that if you look across the whole body of the research, all the different items that members were able to score with different scores during the research, on this 5-point Likert scale that we described before, a large number of them were scored right in about the 4-point range on a 5-point scale. So they were moderately satisfied. They were moderately happy. They thought that the society was moderately performing. Even more than neutral, a little bit on the high side, a 4 on a 5-point scale. But I think that we need to be cautious about this because, in my view, what I believe the potential for the society is and to change lives through singing needs to be delivered at a level of a 5. And I believe that the management team and the board of directors of the society concurred with that idea when we presented it. But a 4 is a number that could lull us into smugness. It could lull us into inaction. If our scores on satisfaction were in the 3 range or the 2 range or the 1 range, it might alarm us into some action. But a 4 can lull us into complacency. So we need to think of a 4, a number that you'll see a relatively large number of times during this presentation as an indication that we're doing some things right, but we can definitely do them better. And if we really want to excel and really want to achieve what we think we can achieve, we need to keep working towards higher scores than fours. Water finds its own level. One of the questions that we asked, and then were able to dissect the data according to, was what kind of chapter do you belong to? We came up with five different types of chapters that members indicated they more or less belong to: a competition-focused chapter, a show-focused chapter, a community-focused chapter, a social/fellowship-focused chapter, and a quartetting-focused chapter. And while people have relatively different opinions depending on the type of chapter they belong to, the divergence in their satisfaction wasn't that great according to the chapter size. So what it tells us is that over time, a member will find the barbershopping experience that is appropriate for that that member's needs and wants and desires and aspirations. So water will find its own level within the Barbershop Harmony Society. We found that we are succeeding at building pillars. Now, if you don't know what pillars are an idea that was introduced at the end of 2015 as a way of trying to describe and organize all the many different things that the Barbershop Harmony Society currently does. There are four pillars that we've established for the Barbershop Harmony Society, which are a way of organizing our current work and our current resource allocation. I'll read them to you here briefly. The first pillar is that through the medium of Barbershop Harmony Society, we maintain and expand supportive services for a global community of artists. Number two, through the medium of barbershop singing, we elevate artistic and leadership skills through education and best practices. Number three, through the medium of barbershop singing, we establish lifelong singing as a core community asset. And then fourth, we scale our impact by growing social enterprise, individual philanthropy, and institutional philanthropy. So the first three are all the effects that come through the medium of Barbershop Harmony Society: building and expanding as supportive services for a global community of artists, elevating artistic and leadership skills through education and best practices, and establishing lifelong singing as a core community asset. And then the fourth one is about growing and getting bigger so that we can do more, scaling our impact by building revenue through social enterprise, which is our earned income activities, individual philanthropy, which is what we're able to do with the good help and support and partnership with the Harmony Foundation, and institutional philanthropy, which is a future revenue source that has to do with fundraising through grant making and national foundations that could fund the society. The reason I mention these to you here is that many of the questions in the survey touch on the different programs and activities and services and benefits that we're providing in those four areas. And across the board, those tended to be areas, even though the members who replied to the survey didn't really know that they were replying about the pillars, they tended to be areas that we're doing relatively well in. The next key conclusion is that intrinsic benefits survive. At a couple of different points in the survey, we asked members, you know, where do you ultimately get your jolly? Why do you even do this hobby that we call barbershop? And they all spoke about intrinsic benefits, things that they feel and they experience and that they know, rather than simplistic objective things and benefits that they receive. So it ultimately comes down to what happens to them because they sing. And with all the things that can happen in a chapter, in a quartet, in a chorus, in the society, programs that may come and go, leaders that may come and go, directors that may come and go, all of these things, at the end of the day, surviving all the controversies and the challenges are these intrinsic benefits, I think, which are probably best described by that mysterious alchemy of which I spoke earlier. Those things last and keep people coming back to the Barbershop Harmony Society. The final conclusion is that untapped generosity remains. So we had a series of questions measuring people's ability to support the organization philanthropically. And the very good news in that area was that there's a lot of generosity, and it's generosity that people have not fully utilized or expounded upon. Well, those conclusions are, as I stated at the beginning, represent the 12 key takeaways from this research. Now, in a moment, I'm going to move into a much more data-driven presentation. Instead of seeing a lot of words on the screen, you're going to see a lot of graphics with data that I've tried to make easy to digest, but it still is data. So at this point, if you chose to leave the presentation, first of all, nobody would know, but second of all, nobody would blame you. But there are some really interesting factoids that come out of the data that comes after this. So you're completely invited to stay around and see how that plays out. You can also, as you know, at any point, as this is posted on YouTube, as I go into this data, you can stop and look at a slide for a little bit longer than I've left it on the screen. I'll be moving through the slides pretty quickly. But you can, just using the stop button on your YouTube, you can take it at the pace that is most digestible for you. So with that, we're gonna go forward with the data. First of all, I want to talk to you about the profile of the people that we spoke to, just so you know who was in this survey. So in general, the respondents tended to be older. That's no surprise because of the demographics of the society. There's a slight, not a huge, but a slight underrepresentation of our younger and newer members. As I said before, it's a heavily Caucasian data set. They represent multiple sizes and types of chapters, so there's certainly no one kind of chapter that is here. As I noted before, the respondents tended to be quartetters, and they tended to be highly engaged in their chapter and not so highly engaged outside of the chapter. So in terms of their age, you can see here that 87% of the respondents were over the age of 45, and 56% were over the age of 65, with a much smaller representation in the younger age groups. And these are the age groups that we drew some interesting conclusions on, so just be aware of that as we drew those conclusions. Now, to look at this in terms of their representation versus the society as a whole, this chart attempts to do it. The way to read this chart is that the blue bars indicate the age distribution of the survey respondents, while the red bars indicate the age distribution of the society as a whole. So, for example, 3% of the respondents to the survey were under the age of 25, while 5% of the respondents of the Barbershop Harmony Society as a whole are under the age of 25. So that group is a little bit underrepresented. The 45 to 64 year old age group is overrepresented, and the other age groups are pretty closely aligned in terms of their representation in the survey compared to their representation in the society as a whole. We asked about length of membership. 62% of the respondents have been members for 16 or more years, and 35% of those have been members for 30 plus years. Again, relative to their representation in the society as a whole, all of the groups of members under the age or under the under five years or less membership in the society were underrepresented in this sample size. racial and ethnic identity. I mentioned this before, 95% of respondents were Caucasian. 60% of respondents hold a regular membership. In terms of the age at which the respondents first joined the society, 25 to 44 is the most common age at which these respondents joined. 39% joined at some point during that age range. But substantial portions also responded when they were younger, 27% under the age of 25, and when they were older, 34% over the age of 45. We asked them to tell us what size chapters they belong to, and a pretty sizable majority of them, 76% in total, were in chapters ranging from 11 to 50 members. We asked, what was the first introduction to the society? What was the reason that you first joined, or the opportunity that you were first given to join? And if anyone tells you that a member referral isn't important, look again at this data. 51% were introduced to the society through another member. By the way, these numbers add up to more than 100%, because we asked them to answer all of these that apply. But still, 51% of these members, the driving force was a member referral. Other, which was kind of a catch-all, was 28%. 23% were because they saw the chorus singing. So singing well in public does indeed draw attention and draw members. But finally, notice this, the sort of marketing areas where we actually have some control as a society as a whole, through our social media, our website, even our Valentine's programs or direct mail from the society, are almost negligible. They are negligible in terms of being driving forces for joining the Barbershop Harmony Society. So the importance of memberships and the importance of choruses performing in a way in public that will attract new members to the society cannot be underestimated. Now, we asked about quartetting. I said before that we were a quartetting society. Look at this. 79% of the respondents have ever been part of a quartet. Not necessarily currently, but they've ever been part of a quartet. And we specifically define this as four specific members who meet somewhat regularly and sing together somewhat regularly, as opposed to the great pickup quartets that often sing during our chapter meetings, or groups of woodshedders, or tagging circles, or informal quartetting. So these are gentlemen who really and truly have been part of a quartet, and 79% of the respondents have done that. Now, of those 79% who have been part of a quartet, 84% of them have been part of a registered quartet. And of those registered quartets, 84% have been part of a competing quartet. So we are indeed a society of quartetters. We'll talk a little bit more about that question of which comes first, the chicken or the egg, but quartetting is darn important. Everybody replied to this question as to what their primary current role within the chapter or chorus was. This tells us that we have a highly engaged group of members. So 34% of members are singers on the risers in their chorus. At the other end of the spectrum, 11% are not actively involved in their chapter at all. That means that 55% are, in addition to obviously being a member on the risers, are taking on some other significant role. They're part of the board, they're part of the music team, they have some other significant responsibility non-musically in the chorus. Maybe they're in charge of moving the risers on Tuesday night rehearsals. Whatever it might be, of all of our members, only 11% can accurately say that they're not engaged in some important way at the grassroots in their chapter. Now, we also asked them whether they have a significant role in any other programs or activities outside of their chapter. And this chart, I purposely hid the labels for this chart for the moment, but you can see there's more than a dozen other roles or activities in which members could be engaged outside of their specific chapter activities. And there's two roles in which about 41% of the respondents are engaged. And then you can see that the list drops off substantially from there. Again, you could answer more than one item, so these will not add up to 100%. So I would ask you, can you guess what the number one item, the 41% item is in which members are engaged? 41% of members are engaged in this activity, and that activity is singing Valentines. Okay, now can you guess what the next activity is? Well, this was a bit of a trick question because the next activity was actually none. So 41% engaged in singing Valentines, 40% engaged in no other activity, and then 11% in some sort of coaching capacity. And from there, it drops off almost to statistical insignificance, 8% in harmony grades, 7% in a division or district board or committee, 6% in ASO, 5% in a harmony explosion camp, 5% as arrangers, et cetera, et cetera. This finding I thought a little bit surprising. I've never met a fisherman who doesn't lie about the fish that he catches. And I'm not sure that it would be accurate to necessarily say that 51% of all of our members have a personal skill level that would rate as high. You would expect the average to be by large the largest slice of this pie. So I found that a little bit humorous in the data. And then with no statistical importance at all, I asked myself, what kind of a quartet or a chorus would these respondents make? Based on their voice parts. And as I'm often told in my chorus, we could use a little bit more bass. I spoke earlier about the usage of BHS events and about the amount of effort that goes into events at different levels relative to the opportunities for branding, messaging, partnership, outreach, and excitement. So the data that sort of supports that conclusion starts with talking about who attended the convention in Pittsburgh. Remember, this research was fielded in May and June of this year, so it was before Nashville, so we used Pittsburgh as our baseline for understanding national or international convention attendance. 24% of the respondents attended Pittsburgh. Then we asked about lifetime attendance at international conventions. And you see that we've got this cohort of really heavy users, 38% who have attended five or more internationals, 8% have attended 20% or more. But at the other end of the spectrum, 30% who have never attended an international convention, and 42% who have attended one or none of our international conventions. So 42% light users. So we've got 38% heavy users and 42% light users or non-users. Now, if we look at Reno in 2016, which was the most recent midwinter before this research went into the field, 7% of the respondents had attended to Reno. Lifetime, 68% are non-users. 71% light users of midwinter conventions. But now look here, 60% of the respondents attended their last district or division convention. And over the course of time, 70% have attended at least five, and 33% have attended 20 or more district conventions. So we've got 70% heavy users, only 9% non-users. These are arguably our most popular offerings, but they're ones that we haven't collectively found a way, as opposed to doing it district by district, to really optimize the impact of these in branding, messaging, recruitment, outreach, and partnership opportunities. So it seems like there's a big opportunity there. 7% had attended the previous Belmont Harmony University in 2015. And similar proportions of non-users show up for Harmony University. 61% have never attended a Harmony University. Another 16% have only attended one. So 71% have attended one or less Harmony universities. Now we asked about the identity of the chapter in which the respondent is a member. In cases of respondents that belong to more than one chapter, we asked them to think of these questions in terms of the ones that they consider to be their primary affinity. The chapters who identify as show-focused chapters and social focus focus are the two highest common denominators across the full spectrum of respondents. A competitive focus is relatively low, and perhaps no surprise, tends to be one that is held by the larger chapters. And despite the number of quartetters or members who have quartetted, chapters who are focused heavily on quartets are also a relatively low occurring event. So to look at that sort of graphically, these are ranked questions, so we ask them to take each of these ideas and rank them as to the one that is the closest to their identity, the second closest, and the third closest. So the higher scores indicate a higher ranking across the body. The score on show focus was 3.6, followed closely by social and fellowship focused at 3.4. And then the community service orientation and the competition focus are fairly lower than that at 3.0 and 2.9, and then only an average ranking of 2.1 for the quartet focused chapter. So we thought it might make sense to look at this same data cross-referenced against the size of the chapter, and we found some interesting things. If you look at the community service focused chapter, the community service focused chapter tends to be the smaller chapter. If you look at the competition-focused chapter, it tends to be the larger chapter. If you look at the quartetting-focused chapter, it tends to be the really small chapter. And if you looked at the show-focused chapter, you see that just about every chapter size, with the exception of the very small chapter, who's probably not in a position to mount their own show, every chapter size other than the 10-member or smaller chapter has a strong indication towards a quartet focus, or I'm sorry, towards a show focus. And then finally, the social fellowship focus chapter tends to almost reduce in importance and ranking as the chapter gets bigger. Again, that might not be totally surprising just based on the difficulties of connecting with 50 or 81 or 125 men compared to connecting with a smaller group of members. I'm moving now into the area of personal satisfaction. And the essence of these questions were, where do you get your jollies in barbershop singing? So I talked about this before in terms of intrinsic benefits and in terms of the idea of what really makes you happy and satisfied about barbershop singing. This was, these benefits were relatively consistent across all the different cohorts. And as I mentioned earlier, younger members tended to be happier in general, and specifically happy with singing tags and polecats and singing in contests, and happy with the opportunity for personal growth that we discussed earlier. And this is where I derived the conclusion mentioned earlier about this mysterious alchemy of ringing together. So the way this question was asked was, we said, following are several statements that might indicate, describe the personal satisfaction you obtain as a member of the Barbershop Harmony Society. Please indicate how much you agree or disagree with each of these following statements. So the first statement was, the pure enjoyment of ringing chords is personally satisfying to me. And on a 5-point scale, that received a 4.7. The impact on people, the impact we make on people and communities when we sing for them is personally satisfying, 4.7. The fellowship with other men in the society is satisfying to me, 4.6. The pursuit of musical and artistic excellence is personally satisfying to me. All of these things are things that happen intrinsically to the barbershop singer. Then things like witnessing great performances by great choruses and quartets, service to the community through my chapter, singing polecats with others, singing tags with others, competing in Barbershop Harmony Society contests, 4.0, pretty satisfying, but certainly not the driver that the pure enjoyment of ringing chords is, and so forth. Now, this was one where we decided that I thought I saw a trend in the data, and I dug into it to try to look at these and see if we could see any, detect any differences in the answers to these based on the demographics. And the one that did show some significance was the one around age. So in this series of charts, the blue bar represents the mean score of all the respondents. The red bar indicates newer members, less than 5 years. And then the one that stands out here is on many of these charts is the under 25 age group. So on the pure enjoyment of ringing chords is personally satisfying to me across the board, 4.7, and not a huge difference by age or length of membership. The impact we make on people and communities when we sing for them is personally satisfying. Again, a high score across the board, slightly lower for the under 25 singer. Fellowship with other men in the society, high and even across demographics. Pursuit of artistic and musical excellence, high and even with a little bit of an uptick among the younger members. Witnessing great performances by top level quartets and choruses, again, high and relatively even. Service to the community, a little bit lower, relatively even. But now look at this. Young singers love the polecats. They love learning tags. They love competing. Substantial difference compared to the norm. They see this real strong indicator of the opportunity for personal development and improved leadership skills through involvement in my chapter, district, or BHS. I believe that that 4.73 that is rated here by the under 25 member is probably the highest single score on any of the scales in all of this research. And I think that's a remarkable fact, and it's one that should be very good news and very leverageable for our outreach and funding efforts, this fact. Teaching tags to others, huge among young singers. Then we asked the most important aspects of your barbershop experience, and basically the question was about, where is your point of identity with the Barbershop Harmony Society? It's the singing, stupid. It's the chorus first, especially for the young, but the affinity with the barbershop society itself grows over time. So here we asked, again, a similar ranking question. What is the most important aspect of your barbershop experience? Singing in my chorus was an average ranking of 4.2. Quartet singing, not too far behind it, at 3.8. But then look at that drop down to singing, being part of Barbershop Harmony Society as a whole at 2.6. The non-singing aspects of my chapter at 2.3. And participating in district activities at 2.1. Now, everything can't be the most important thing, so this is a relative ranking, but it tells you really where the action is. And that might give some clues as to where we invest resources and attention in order to maintain fanatically happy fans. This fact, by the way, was relatively stable across the ages. Singing in my chorus across the length of membership, I should say. Singing in my chorus tends to be that way. Quartet singing tends to be a little bit less popular among the newer members of the society, not necessarily the younger singers, but the newer members, sort of suggesting that the chorus is the gateway drug that might eventually lead to quartetting. Affinity tends to grow over time, so there's a fairly significantly higher affinity for Barbershop Harmony Society as a whole among the longer-term members than among the nearer-term members. The non-singing aspects of my chorus tend to be pretty even and not very high across all lengths of membership, as do those relatively low rankings of district activities and district membership. We asked about the value of membership, specifically the value of an array of member benefits that are available through the Barbershop Harmony Society. Again, this idea of the risk of moderate satisfaction came through loud and clear with this question. What the data doesn't tell us is on any given point, on any given item of membership, where they might have ranked that particular item lower than others, it doesn't tell us whether that item is not really valuable to them or whether they just don't really know about it. But this does give us some ideas and some implications for where we ought to be investing resources and capacity in the future. Again, younger singers were most enthusiastic about just about everything, and they were extra enthusiastic about discounts, about competing, and about the social aspects of barbershop. So the benefits that we measured for, the items that received above a 4-point rating in terms of the value are as follows. Singing on chapter shows and events is valuable to me. That was valued at a 4.6 average rating. The service that the society provides by offering a library of published and unpublished arrangements was seen as valuable at a level of 4.3. The harmonizer subscription that comes with membership is valued at a 4.2. Being allowed to sing in Barbershop Harmony Society contests valued at a 4.2. The discount on the marketplace, 4.1. And the Barbershop Polecat book, also a 4.1. Then a slightly lower group in that sort of 3.5 to 4-point range includes the musical and clearance services, musical clearance and licensing services that the society provides, the live wire, the international discount, the member kit, men of note recognition, only a 3.7 for our social media platforms, attending Harmony University, the leadership forum, Harmony University discount, etc. Again, on the theme of enthusiasm of youth, take a look at this series of charts. Again, the all members or all respondents is represented by the blue, and the under 25 age group is represented by the light green. singing on chapter shows, slightly higher affinity for that. Appreciation for the arrangements, slightly higher appreciation by the under 25 age group. Less engagement with the harmonizer. Remember, that's a print vehicle. Younger members, as we'll see later, tend to favor electronic communication, particularly social media. Being allowed to sing in Barbershop Harmony Society contests, 4.84. So I guess I lied a few slides ago when I said that 4.78 on personal development was the highest score, but it was pretty close to this one. Huge value to younger singers. Younger singers love discounts more than the average person. They like the Polecat book, the starter drug, again, for learning to sing basic barbershop. They appreciate the society's music clearance and licensing services at a higher level. Less into live wire, that's by email rather than social media, so perhaps not a big surprise. Love the member discount for the international convention. Like the member kit more than the average member. Likes to be recognized as a man of note for bringing a friend in. Huge fan of our social media platforms, YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. Even likes Harmony University, even though if you dig into the data, the attendance by this age group is relatively low, so perhaps it's just the idea of attending Harmony University. Sees greater value in the leadership forum, in the discount for Harmony University, in the discount for the Midwinter Convention. There's a theme emerging here, wouldn't you say? Appreciates the existence of the Music Educator Guide. Likes being recognized as a Polecat. Sees value in the Harmony University online program, which is not yet a huge program, and even sees greater value in our You Sing program. So I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that across the board, the young men, at least those who responded to this survey, are more enthusiastic than we're doing about what we're doing than jaded old men like me. Okay, now we asked about specific performance of the chapter and the district and the society as a whole. How are we actually doing in delivering the things that are important to you as a member? And once again, we'll see this idea of the risk of moderate satisfaction. And nowhere is that borne out more clearly than in this slide. So the way this slide was constructed is we had a series of indicators of high performance or lack thereof by the chapter and the district and the society. They were different indicators for each of those three bodies because what each of those three bodies does is different. And then we averaged them all together based on their average rating, and we came up with these average summary scores for the overall ranking. So on average, on a 5-point scale, my chapter is doing a 3.94. My district is doing a 3.62, and society as a whole is doing a 3.94. These are all below 4.0, I would point out, and therein lies the risk of moderate satisfaction. When we asked how your chapter is doing, again, that's the one that garnered a 3.94 average score, we find that in most chapters, you get what you ask for. You, as we said, water seeks its own level, and you migrate to the chapter that's going to meet your needs. There's generally a higher level of optimism among competitive and show choruses, or chapters, I should say, and less optimism among the social and fellowship oriented chapter. The rankings of chapters were about quality of musical leadership, commitment of time and effort, about a healthy and positive culture and environment, whether the chapter gives me a voice, whether it requires a financial commitment of me that is consistent with what I'm able to give, whether it has good administrative leaders. Key question, is it headed in the right direction? Is it making an impact in our community? Is it likely to grow and improve? And does it sing at a level that is consistent with the level that I want to sit at, sing at? So again, we identified these five different types of chapters. And now let's look at those responses by type of chapter. Here, the blue bar on the left indicates all respondents, and then each of the other colored bars indicates a different type of chapter. Does my chapter have good musical leaders? The average on that across the entire body of respondents was a 4.27. The social and fellowship chapter is somewhat lower than that, and the competition-focused chapter tends to have higher satisfaction with its musical leaders. Just about every chapter type, with very little variance, believes that their chapter requires a commitment of time and effort that is consistent with how much that individual wants to commit. So they're finding the chapter that suits them best. My chapter has a healthy, positive atmosphere and culture. That tends to be a lower score among the social and fellowship focused chapter than among the other chapter types. Gives me a voice in its affairs and is responsive to my needs. Pretty consistent across all chapter types, as is the requisite financial commitment. Fairly consistent across all types of chapters. Less satisfaction with the administrative leadership in the social and fellowship focused chapter and in the quartet focused chapter than in the other chapter types. Also, and this is a fairly significant finding, is the overall measurement about whether my chapter is headed in the right direction tends to be lower among the social and fellowship focus chapter. The community service oriented chapter has a much higher score on making an impact in our community, and the social and fellowship focused chapter has a lower score. And then, perhaps no surprise, the competition focused chapter, with that focus on competition and improvement, tends to answer that it is likely to grow, or the member of that chapter tends to believe that his chapter is likely to grow and improve in the future at a higher rate than other respondents, and the social and fellowship focused chapter has quite the opposite response, much less optimism about growth and improvement in the future. And the competition focused chapter tends to be more satisfied with the level of singing in that chapter, and the member of the social and fellowship focused chapter tends to be less satisfied. At the level of the district, that of the three levels of barbershop hierarchy, if you will, had the lowest overall satisfaction score of 3.62. Across the board, the scores here were below 4, and there were noticeable differences, and I won't spend a lot of time on these, but in large part, the ratings of the members of the Illinois and the Seneca Land District tended to be fairly consistently lower than the other districts. The Carolinas and Cardinal chapters tended to have substantially higher appreciation for their performance. And to a smaller extent, the Far Western and Evergreen districts and Johnny Appleseed and Mid-Atlantic District also tended to perform a little bit higher. Overall, my district has good leaders, was rated at 3.9, has a healthy, positive culture, was rated at a 3.8, headed in the right direction, 3.6, has valuable programs, and that's that question actually said, has valuable programs that improve and enhance my personal barbershop experience, was a 3.6, likely to improve and grow in the future, 3.6, valuable leadership, 3.5, and gives me a voice and is responsive, 3.4. I'm just going to flip through these slides very quickly. You're going to see lots of indicators of those couple of chapters that tend to perform lower than the mean. The mean is over there on the left in that all score in the blue bar on the left. And then you'll see some, like in this case, Carolina's district, that tends to perform above the mean. Carolinas and Cardinal are performing above the mean here. We then asked, the final sort of series of questions was, how is the Barbershop Harmony Society as a whole doing? And this is where the mean score was a 3.94, almost identical to the mean score of the chapter. As a whole, the society was seen as being strongest in those pillar areas that we discussed a little bit earlier, weakest in the areas of governance, voice, giving voice to the members, responsiveness, and resource delivery. And again, with youth being more appreciative pretty much across the board. The ranking of the society ranged from a 4.2 down to a 3.3. You can see that a little bit better on this slide. How is the Barbershop Harmony Society doing in these areas? And the areas that I will focus on in this moment is, the highest ranked one was helping to elevate the artistry and excellence of barbershop singing. That was the highest ranked item. That's a pillar item. Second is helping to advocate for the arts in general and the choral arts more specifically, not directly a pillar item, but highly ranked. Number three is helping to promote the idea of lifelong singing as a key asset for individuals and communities, a 4.1. That's a pillar item. Is helping to elevate artistic barbershop's artistic and leadership skills through its educational offering, a 4.1, a pillar item. Has a healthy, positive atmosphere and culture. Now we're moving into the moderate satisfaction level of a 4.1. Helping to build a strong national or global barbershop community, another pillar item. And has a strong management team and staff at Harmony Hall. All of those were items above a 4.0. And then a number that were below, and in a couple cases well below a 4.0, creating excitement and interest for barbershop singing, making an impact on our communities by getting more young men singing, is headed in the right direction, a 3.9. Has a strong national board of directors, a 3.8. Provides valuable resources for my chapter, a 3.7. And then a fairly seriously low number of a 3.3 around the idea that the Barbershop Harmony is, as a whole, gives me a voice and is in its affairs and is responsive to my needs. And no surprise, you've seen this enough that I won't go into it in much detail here. Young people across all these ratings tend to rate us, the Barbershop Harmony Society, much higher than the average member. Youthful exuberance. If we could bottle it, we'd make a fortune. The final area was about the untapped generosity. This data tells us that there's significant room for growth in the philanthropic programs of the society. This is good news to all who benefit from those programs. So 47% of the respondents have made a gift to the Harmony Foundation in the past. 43% are likely to in the future, but rather than the other 57% being people who have said no, more than half of those, or 30% of the total, are uncertain, meaning that a case can be made to them for contributing to the foundation in the future. And if you look here at the universe of all non-givers, so the people who have not given in the past, 14% say that they will give in the future, and another 41% are uncertain about their ability and willingness to give in the future, meaning that there is potential that could be released with the right programs and the right appeal that convinces those members of the worthiness of an investment in the Barbershop Harmony Society. And those same data are true across the chapter and district giving level as well. So going back to the key conclusions, just to wrap this up, you saw here evidence that we're a demographically isolated, primarily Caucasian society. You saw this interesting interplay between quartetting and the chorus, and this question of which comes first, the chicken or the egg, and the need to support them both. You saw a lot of evidence of the heavier engagement at the grassroots chapter level than at any other level of the society by these respondents. You saw that interplay between the attendance at International, Midwinter, and Harmony University versus the higher attendance at district level conventions. We talked about this mysterious alchemy of singing together, ringing chords really well together for the benefit of others, and the power of that. Across the board, youth are more enthusiastic about the society than any other given segment. And they see this real value of personal development. The risk of moderate satisfaction is real and real. We're doing well, but we could be doing much better. And we cannot be lulled into complacency by all those four level scores. Water finds its own level. Members find the chapter that suits them. Members are broadly satisfied with how we're going about building the pillars. And no matter what we do, the benefits, the personal benefits, the jollies that men get by singing Barbershop seem to survive everything else that we do. And there's untapped generosity on the behalf of these members. So that concludes the presentation. I hope that I gave you both at a macro level with the 12 key conclusions at the beginning and the end, and with the detailed data, a real clear glimpse into how the society is doing by its members. You will note that this video is posted publicly on YouTube, meaning that we invite our friends, whether they're barbershoppers or not, to really take a good close look at what we're doing. If there's anything in here that you can learn from, that your chapter, district, or other organization can learn from, we offer it to you with open arms in the spirit of transparency and in the spirit that all singing makes all of us better and makes the world better. If you have any questions about this presentation or about the long-term strategic planning process at the Barbershop Harmony Society, feel free to write to us at strategy@barbershop.org. And with that, I want to thank you for your time today and for your attention. And on behalf of the Barbershop Harmony Society, on the behalf of our mission of creating a better world singing, this is Kevin Lynch signing off. Over and out. Thank you very much for your attention. Bye-bye.